If you remember the lesson that I did a couple of years ago, I have presented many results about the use of MXN in the fitting of the Xensky energy region. At that time, I just say a few words about MXN because I did my presentation focusing on the application and the possibility that we have explored with MXN.
Recording in progress.
I say that with the lesson today, I would like to give you some more details about the MXN. It's about MXN and a short discussion about the strength, perhaps the strength you have already seen what MXN is able to do, but also I would like to give you some information about the limits that this program has in the calculation of the Xensky energy region. This work is done in collaboration with Nico Sanna. Nico Sanna is a professor of University of Viterbo Latuscia, and with him and with Giovanni Chillemini, we did the engineerization, the new version of MXN. They did all the engineerization of the software with and also developed the idea of using this docking stuff to share the program in the scientific community. What happens? Oh, mamma mia, ma che è adesso? I'm sorry, but I don't understand why. Okay, we do it this way. And let me give you some main points about MXN. Essentially, you already know that MXN is able to fit the Xensky energy region in terms of structural parameter that you can choose in the program in several ways. And the first point is that this is something that I already said the last time, that the MXN works in the full multiple scattering framework. Essentially, we don't make any series expansion like done by other programs that are able to fit the Xensky energy region. MXN works in the Muffington approximation for the shaded potential and in the framework of the so-called extended continuous scheme. I will speak a little bit more about this Muffington approximation and the extended continuous scheme, which is essentially a different way to normalize the final state wave function, and this way we treat the bound state as a resonance in the continuum energy region. MXR works in the energy space, so we don't need, as usually done in the standard analysis, the transformation of the reciprocal space. So this is something that we don't need to do for the fitting procedure. There is not the bipolar correction in the calculation, although this is something that can be done because some years ago I have developed a scheme based on the augmented space formally to introduce the bipolar in the calculation, the full calculation of the cross-section. But at the end, these things is not so really important for practical uses. And also there is the possibility of using polarized spectrum. So let's give you some information about the Muffington approximation, just to remember what what we are speaking. So the buffing thinness is essentially easy way to divide the space where is the cluster of your calculation in three regions. The first one of the tar sphere is sphere where are centered in the atomic position, and inside the potential is developed in the spherical harmonics, and normally the and this is what MXN does, we use only the spherical part. The multiple contribution is not considered in the calculation, and also there are, but from a theoretical point of view, the inclusion of the multiple part of the potential is not difficult, and at the end is not so important for practical calculation. There are region number two, which is the interstitial region, and in this region the potential is a constant potential. After, there is a region number three, which is a region outside this outer sphere, where essentially the potential is in some way done in order is a spherical, again is a spherical average potential respect to the center of the cluster, and the details of this potential depend on the physical problem that you want to solve, because the multiple scattering theory is something that is not used only for XAS calculation, but also for other type of calculation where you need to find the electronic state. The standard continuous scheme is a scheme where essentially by changing the normalization of the final state wave function, we eliminate the outer sphere. Essentially, we do a transition between, this is the K, which is the standard Muffin-Thin approximation, to these things where the continuous region essentially start from the Muffin-Thin potential, and from this point onward, all the states that are present, no matter if they are bound state to state of the continuum part of the energy spectrum, are calculated because the bound state become resonance in the continuum part of the spectrum. This is something that has been discussed in this paper many years ago now, because the time is going, and also for the first time has appeared in the literature in this paper of Sebastian Donag that has been presented in the EXAS and Young Structure Conference number 3, Stanford, 1984, so almost 40 years ago. So to summarize, which is the extended continuum is essentially we eliminate the outer sphere doing this changing of the normalization of the final state wave function. We found the bound state as a continuous resonance, and essentially in this way we can calibrate on the same energy scaling without the need to do other calculation the bound state part and the extent, the continuum part of the spectrum, because you know that perhaps you already seen in this school that sometime in the XAS spectrum appear some feature in the pre-edge energy region, or even in the rising edge that feature that sometime are really connected with the bound state, some other time this connection is not so clear, but in this way we can calculate in the same energy scale the XANES spectrum starting as I say from the edge. This is an example, so always done taken from this proceeding that Seb with Morse Berding did at that time, so more than almost 40 years ago. And this is the experiment, the polarized experiment of this compound. And you see the for example, if you focus the attention on these two features, which is done for a polarization vector of the light along the one of the bond, the CUCL bond, and this is the calculation. You see that okay, there is problem with intensity, but the two feature peak are well reproduced, and the energy separation between the two features are in rather good agreement with the experimental finding. But this is something that has been done 40 years ago, so now we are able to do a better calculation using this this scheme. This is just I decided to show you these things because this is something that in some ways is an historical calculation, because the time was 40 years ago, but something that is important just to remember what the people did in the past. Okay, the structure of the theory in the standard continuous key is the same, the standard multiple scattering approach, so the core of the calculation is always the scattering party operator, and of course what you must do is to inverse to calculate this scattering party operator, and in MMXN this is done using a full calculation, which means that okay, there is an expansion in terms of spherical harmonic of all the operators that are present in the theory, but after that the inversion is done exactly by numerical tools. Let me say about something about the Maffentin approximation. Of course, and for sure the Kesuge that should speak after me will present you a real non-Maffentin type of program. But in any case, it is possible to say something, because this is, in my opinion, and is a kind of theoretical explanation why, in most of the cases in MXN, we don't have so much problem with the Maffentin approximation. And the argument is the following. In 86, Rino, I, and Seb proposed in the literature a theory to overcome the Maffentin approximation, and at the end of the derivation, we have demonstrated that it's possible to introduce non-Maffentin correction that just modify the T-matrix and the free electron propagator between sides. Essentially, there are some corrections that you need to include to see if you want to overcome the Maffentin approximation, and this correction essentially depends on the structure of the potential in the interstitial region, and it depends on the size of the interstitial region respect to the whole cluster. So if you do this, you write these things, including the correction, you can essentially develop the total cross-section in terms of the correction that you must introduce in the T-matrix and the free electron propagation to include the non-Maffentin correction. So if you do this as a kind of series expansion, this is very easy, and essentially there are, you see that the first term of this series expansion is the Maffentin calculation, and so the total cross-section outside the Maffentin approximation is the total cross-section calculated with the Maffentin approximation plus some correction. The fact that the non-Maffentin correction can be introduced in the theory just changing a little bit the T-matrix and the free electron propagator suggests us that it is possible to introduce this correction in a kind of phenomenological way. Of course, it's much better that we can do this exactly, but just to have something that is able to run easily in to make to for practical application. So our idea was, okay, we can change the non-muffin tier, essentially we can change the muffin tier radii, the interstitial potential, in order to minimize in order to mimic the fact that there are some correction for the non-muffin tier part of the potential, and in this way we try to minimize the effect of the non-muffin tier correction. So now this means that we have modified MXN, and we have introduced in the MXN loop within the structural loop. So in this way we can also make to study the correlation between this part of the potential with the structural parameters. Essentially if we like to do this, a minimization of the program make a kind of fitting also in the interstitial potential, the muffin theory, in order to have the best agreement. This has been proposed for the first time in this paper that we wrote in 2005, and also is described in details in our last paper dealing with the MXN that disappeared this year in computer physics communication. Let's go to another critical point, a point which is a little bit delicate, which is the phenomenological damping that we use in the MXN calculation. I wrote here, just to remember you, which is the meaning of the error function. Last time when I spoke, and I did the presentation 2 days ago, you remember that there is a short discussion about the possibility to use other form of the error function. This is true, and this is something that should be in some way explored, and to see what is the stability of the solution of in terms of the error function structure, the error function form, but okay, we did not this study essentially for because we have not enough manpower. Also, for example, I have the opinion that other possibilities should be using for fitting not the direct spectrum, the sort of spectrum, for example, the first derivative. For the same, this is something that perhaps can minimize some problems that are with the normalization of the spectrum, and also normally the first derivative is very is able to see details of the spectrum that sometimes with the direct spectrum a little bit. But okay, let's go back to this problem of the exchange correlation part of the potential, and I show you two calculations about the K edge of the zinc in water. The first one, this one, is done using the full complex di Lucas potential. The experiment now is the blue line, while the fit is the red points. Here you see the same calculation done in the same condition, but we're using the phenomenological damping. Two things are important to notice. First, that although with the complex fully Lucas potential, the agreement is not so bad, but the error function you see here is essentially two times the error function obtained with the phenomenological damping. About the structural determination, the two determination more or less are equivalent in reality, because you see the full complex Lucas potential we obtain at 2.09 plus or minus this error, while for the phenomenological damping we obtain 2.07 plus or minus this error, and the DEXAS analysis done with the GNXAS and the publish this analysis in a paper in 2002, we obtained 2.078. So from a structural point of view, in my opinion, the two fit are equivalent, but clearly the fact that we can improve the agreement using the phenomenological debris, at least for this case, for a factor two, is something which is important, because in this way we are able to see more details of the experimental data that sometimes when the fit is not really good, it's impossible to be seen. So, in practice, what we do is the following. Essentially, we use the exchange correlation part, we use the real part of the Deluc exponential, and we introduce the complex part by a convolution with the Lorentzian function that is formed by two pieces. The first one is the corol, that this number can find the table. Are many tables about the value of the corol, but in the program, if you don't want, it also is possible to fit this parameter if you want, or at least to fit in a very narrow window in order to find the best agreement. And the second part is formed by an energy dependent grid that behaves this energy dependence like the universal form. And you can see, for example, this paper, very old paper, again 40 years ago, where Mueller and Wilkins in the dishonest communication report the width and the mean free path on several materials, and they used this form for a band type of calculation of XAS in several metals. And this width start from the let's say this is essentially the form of the width. This width, there are two parameters that the program adjust during the fitting procedure, but this parameter outside the structural loop, and essentially this is an amplitude, that this AS control the amplitude of this width, and the ES is the starting of this damping. Let's say it's very close to, let's say, what we can standard in Lucas is the plasma excitation, and these parameter ES and AS are derived derived on the basis of Monte Carlo type of fit in MXM program. So the form is always the same. What change is this amplitude and this the onset of this complex part. So it's possible to justify this phenomenological approach. In my opinion, yes, because this, I wrote here some points. Let's say that if you have only one channel, the last channel dominates, and when the case where the last channel dominates, and at the end when we discuss a little bit the limitation, I show you some cases where there are other contributions that are present in the Xenon speed, and when these contributions are present, of course the MXN does not work. We cannot apply the MXN for this type of cases. And if perhaps you already seen this part during the lesson, that when you have only one channel, the your cross section essentially is the imaginary part of the green function, that this green function obey to a Dyson like type of equation, that and the point is that how to calculate this optical potential. And there are it's possible to demonstrate that in this case this is equivalent to make a convolution with the real part of the potential, and but convoluted with the Lorentzian function with a suitable energy dependent width. Also, I want to show you this figure, because the idea that is behind this phenomenological approach is that in the sudden limit of the multi-channel multiple scattering theory, this is the theory that we proposed many years ago in the 1990, and after you can find some other consideration in this paper appeared in 2003 in Journal Circular Radiation, that and also there is a nice discussion that you can find in this paper, the old paper, in the two papers of John Rare in 86 and this review Modern Physics appeared in 2000 about this story. But essentially what happens that if you works in the sudden limit of the multi-channel multiple scattering theory, your cross-section is the sum of several independent contributions, each one for each electronic channel present in your system. And if you suppose that the energy separation with this electronic channel is very small, you can transform this sum in an integral, and the answers that in this way you obtain a convolution, and essentially the answers that we did, that this convolution is a Lorentzian function. Just to confirm you this idea, that is something that okay, there are many examples that works, but this is a figure that in my opinion is really interesting, because if you remember the calculation of zinc that I present before, this is the mean free path coming from the complex Dirichlet potential. So at the best fit condition. And this is the blue points. The red points are the mean free path associated with the phenomenological damping of the calculation that I presented before at the best fit condition. Of course, there are differences, because you obtain an error for phenomenological damping, which is half of the error that with the complex part. But you see that they are not so far. In other words, in my opinion, essentially, this is a way, is a phenomenological way, to try to to find, let's say, a method, a practical method that can work for many type of systems, because we are now up to now, okay, most of the application of MXL that we have seen, but we did during the year, belong to molecules, in water, or biological molecules, or whatever. But completely different, because we have done a calculation the case of proteins. We've done calculation in the case of solvation via. We have done calculation many other things with alliance. And you remember the dynamic and molecular dynamics of alliance in water. So we have done many types of different calculation, and it is a way to, in some way, to adjust the complex part of the Dirichlet potential in a phenomenological way. Okay, let's go to the more practical detail. This is the workflow MXN. Essentially, for the calculation, for practical calculation, you need essentially two inputs. The experimental XAS spectrum, which is a standard file with two columns, the energy, which can be the absolute energy or relative energy. Relative essentially respect to the energy of the rising edge. This is a another map you can choose or you want. And of course, as I said last time, some idea about the cluster and that you need to use. So you need to have some starting idea about the cluster, the geometry of the molecule that give rise to the XAS spectrum that you are looking for. After, there is another input that MXI generated automatically, then you need to adjust this input depending on your cases, and then essentially that input you need to choose the structure parameter that you want to fit. There are other information that you need to fix, but this is something that can be done easily. Okay, after there is the workflow is the following. In reality, you see this is the three inputs that MXSun want to run, and this is a kind of scheme about how the MXSun works. And okay, this is at the end when you reach the best fit condition, you get the fit. So all these things is all the information that now I try to show you, to say to you very shortly, can be found in this paper that we published a few months ago in Computer Physics Communication, and they are essentially written everything. How to create the inputs that you want, that MXSun want, how to read the outputs, how to install the program on your computer, and essentially everything that I have shown you in this talk is there. So if you want to run MXSun, I invite you to find this paper, ask us, me or Nico, the paper and also the supplementary information where is explained everything. I want to spend some words about this Docker type of running. Docker type of running is something that is very recent. Essentially, the idea of this Docker stuff is that the program, the imaging of the program is installed somewhere. In the MXSun case, is installed in the computer in Viterbo, the computer that Nico uses for the calculation. And if you download Docker in your computer, there is a Docker for Mac, for normal PC, for Linux, for whatever, you can download in your PC the image of your program, and in this way you don't need to this is some architecture about Docker. I'm not an expert in this, so this is just to show you what happens. But what is important that you don't need to install in your PC any type of compiler. In other words, this is something that was a real problem in the past, because sometimes there are people that want to run on PC or Mac or laptop computer, and sometimes the old version of MXSun needed to install in that computer the compiler to create the image of the program that is possible to run. But in these cases, you don't need to do these things. Here there is some instruction how to run, and after that you install this Docker stuff with a window with the Linux, and essentially you run this image that is taken from an art from Viterbo in your computer without any type of problem. In the paper that we published 2 months ago, this thing is written in details, but in any case, if you want to play with the dog stuff, you begin to stuff, you have a problem, you can send an email to me, Cosanna, which is he's very expert in this type of things, and he can help you without any problem. Okay, I'm going very fast to the end of my talk. I guess that I have another 5 minutes, and I want to show you the cases where sometime where we have problem. The first thing is the system where there is a clear presence of two or more different electronic configuration. One of these cases, for example, if you remember the cuprates for the ITC superconductor. But what I want to show you is the cases of the KH of iron 2 and iron 3 plus in water solution. And I show you like as in the case of iron 2 plus, we can fit the spectrum and we obtain good result. But in the case of iron 3 plus, where there is a clear presence of another peak, the situation is completely different and we cannot make a good fit. This is the experimental data. You see the difference, and essentially we have discussed this in a paper of chemical physics. Also there is another paper that I did with Paolo D'Angelo, appear in Journal Chemical Physics. But what is interesting is that in the iron 2 plus in water, the structure of the experimental feature, experimental science, is a standard structure of octahedral system. There is the main resonance at the edge. After, there is this structure here, which is quite common for octahedral symmetry. While if you go in the iron 3 plus in water, the situation is completely different, because appear this bump here, and this bump from experimental point of view is quite clear. People repeat this experiment many times and you obtain the same result every time. And there is this peak, which is the energy separation from the main peak, and this other peak is the order of 5 electron volt. And essentially, I did the analysis of these things in terms of self-consistent potential. And what I found is that this peak comes from the presence of another electronic configuration, which comes from moving one electron from the low to high T2G level. Again, if you think in terms of sudden limit, when you have two channels like this, then your cross section is a sum of the two different contributions. Of course, each one with an energy that depends on how many energy you lose in the to excite the other electronic configuration. But essentially, there are two features. This is the sum of the contribution of the two Xanax spectrum that are shifted in energy a little bit because of the energy separation of the electronic channel. If you do the calculation and the fit, you obtain these things. Here is the fit of iron 2 plus. There is a rather good agreement. The number, the fit is quite good, and also the number for the iron oxygen distance is good. Is essentially 2 point something, I don't remember the number, that in good agreement with other structural determination. But if you do the same type profit for entry plus, this is what you get, and the there is no way to get a fit. So the error is really big, also the geometry that comes from this fit, let's say, this calculation, which is the calculation of the best fit condition for this spectrum, is something that is very far from octahedral geometry and the number that are not correct. The discussion about this problem, no, iron 2 plus and iron 2 plus, as I said before, is in this chemical physics that within the 2002, and there you can find this fit and also the discussion in terms of the T2G electronic configuration of the final state of these two samples. Another problem comes from the standard continuum approximation. For example, this is the K-edge of sulfur of cysteine. The experiment is these blue points. The fit, this is the cysteine molecule, this one. There are some water around, there are two water, which is, this is the best fit that we did for this system. And this is the best fit is the red line. There is another interesting point of this system, which is very peculiar, that if you make the excess of the system, excess is very weak or even absent. This is something that happened very many times in the sulfur K-edge of several systems. But this is the, you see, essentially there is no feature here. Also, if you go farther in energy, the small oscillation that perhaps you find here disappear. So essentially it's very difficult to analyze this data because essentially we have only two bumps. MXAN is able to treat these things in a very approximately way because it's possible to introduce a weight in the error function that decreases the importance of the this part of the spectrum, depending of how you can define the weight, in order to make the fit more sensible to the part of the spectrum at high energy where, let's say, we don't have this type of problem normally. So this is another case where you can find some problem. Also today, perhaps in the talk of Maddalena Pedio, you have seen that there are also sometimes a little bit, some small problem in the for the K edges of light elements, and because in my opinion there is we need to describe much better the relaxation of the corolla on the charge on the corolla that we created with the experiment, but this is another story that Maddalena today already discussed. So I arrived at the conclusion. In my opinion, I believe that MXAN now can be used quite easily. Of course, it's not the end of the story. It's a program that should be improved in some way, but as I say last time, and I repeat today, we don't have now manpower to do this type of things. But nevertheless, with the last version, in my opinion, can be used to get structural information in many cases. Of course, it's possible to do many type of improvement from a computing point of view to improve the speed. We can imagine to a different type of exchange correlation potential to improve this part of the potential. This is something that can be done. There is the possibility, as I said before, to see the influence of different type of error function, or even to use the first derivative of the spectrum, or use the first derivative and the direct spectrum, something that that can be done. But all these type of improvement need to put the end in the code, and now we don't have the possibility to do this. Of course, if there is some one that want to put the end in the code to do something, it really is really, really welcome. There is no problem for us. Let me finish with the acknowledgements. Again, Elisabetta, that work in the computing. Kesuge, that did a lot of job in Mexan in the past when he was in Frascati. Giovanni Guilemi, that with Nico, that essentially did the engineering of the code in the form that now we are using, in and for also for this Docker type of stuff, and also Pat, Brit, Kit, because they it was a Stanford for many years, and they support me for several years too, and during this period we develop some idea, we develop the calculation, we develop also some application. So this is all, and thanks to everyone for the attention, and okay, and then I finish.
Thank you, Maurizio. And we have a couple of minutes for questions. Okay, then I have a couple of short technical questions.
Okay.
How important is the choice of initial geometry?
That depends. Is normally is not so important. Of course, suppose that you have an octahedral symmetry, and if you start with the tetrahedral symmetry, this is impossible to change. So, in other words, if you work in using, I don't know, let's say this is example of octahedral and tetrahedral. Octahedral symmetry means that you have six atoms around the absorber. Of course, if you put four atoms, this is something that is impossible to recover. But the fit becomes so worse that in some way the fit to force you to change the symmetry.
Okay.
But if the number of atoms is correct, okay, at the beginning we try to, for example, for the octahedral cases, to start from a distorted octahedral to move one bond independent, every bond independent, to move bond coupled together, and the fit in this way is very stable.
I see. And the second question about this Lorentzian. As a user, do I need to do something like to choose a width, for example, or does the code do it for me?
The width, the total width, you mean?
Yeah.
In the comma mean, there is the parameter that control this width. There is a parameter that is the value of the corol, and normally. Okay, we take the value from the table. There are many tables in the market, let's say, in the literature, where you find the corol of almost every atoms almost every atoms, and you can choose, this is your choice, if you want to fit this parameter within a small window, you can fix the value that you find in the table. After, there is the phenomenological part, and you can say to the program that you want to fit this phenomenological part, and you can choose the initial value and the range of the window where MemXA try to find the best fit. So this is something that you can, this is what you can do from this point of view. I don't know if I answer your question.
Thank you. And so no more questions? Then I guess we can thank the speaker again. Thank you, Maurizio.
Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot. And have a nice evening.
Thank you. Then we can move to the next speaker. That is Kiss.